Herb, it's scary to think that you have that all in your head. So more respect to Herb Chen. I'm going to try to spend maybe 20 minutes to 25 minutes just giving you some historical perspective on where this has come and where we've come here at the University of Wisconsin. And then Azam's going to perhaps show the more interesting part of this thing, which is a couple of cases with some video of what this all looks like. So when I first got here in 2007, I actually gave a grand rounds and I entitled it The Anterior Skull Base, A Current View. So that was just 7 years ago, and certainly things have changed in 7 years, at least in this current environment here. When I gave that talk, I talked about the fact that some things change and some things stay the same, and some things change slowly. In actual fact, most things change slowly. In 1968, this was the time when the anterior skull base was really just taking on its beginnings, and the first experience by Van Buren and Ketchum published their 10-year experiences, 1968. And of course, that's the same time the Rolling Stones were kind of at their peak, quote-unquote at their peak, touring the U.S. Today, I don't know how many of you guys know Blake Mills. I just heard about Blake Mills recently, but he's said to be the world's greatest guitarist by two renowned sources, YouTube and the New York Times. So things do change. Blake Mills is somebody I didn't even hear about, but apparently is now the world's greatest guitarist. And actually, I have looked at his YouTubes, and he is pretty spectacular. Really what is new, it's sometimes hard to know. The Cleveland Clinic, who mails things to us on about a monthly basis about the expertise in their world, certainly claims that they've got a program that they're defining as the newest one of the newest advances, and it's this basically this minimally invasive anterior skull base surgery. It's a program obviously akin to the same program that Azam and I and the team has here. It on some levels it is new. What I'll talk about today briefly is why it's new and again what the slow changes have been that's allowed it to occur. I'll talk a little bit about the technical modernization of surgical approach. I'm going to talk a little bit about the tumor pathologies that allow this to occur, a little bit about surgical dogma, risk management, and then just obviously there are changes in adjuvant therapy that we all know about that allow, again, treatment to occur in more patients with significant lower risk. And I think oftentimes lower risk is maybe the reason that these things can be pushed forward. Sort of dating myself a little bit, I'm going to date Tom Pasek along with me. So when Tom and I were residents at the University of Washington in 1980s, this article was actually published by one of our partners, resident partners, Dr. David Isley. David's now the chairman at Hopkins. But he and Charlie Cummings published the series by William Kelly of endoscopic approaches, or not endoscopic approaches, but standard approaches to the pituitary. So this is the way it was done, and it's still done today in most institutions when it comes to dealing with pituitary tumors, at least. And this is a technique that was actually initially defined by Harvey Cushing back in the early 1900s. And it was actually a pretty well-tolerated procedure. In theory, though, he apparently abandoned this procedure to do an anterior frontal approach around 1925, but he claimed to have a low mortality rate of only 5%. But this retractor, this basically Cushing's retractor, is still utilized today through the sublabial transoral approach to the pituitary. In our residency time frame, it wasn't uncommon for us to approach the ethmoid through the face. We would do ethmoid surgeries with transcutaneous incisions. Again, because this was the easiest way to get to the ethmoid cavity and what we thought was a safe way to protect the eye and surrounding structures. So we wrote this little article about how to do this in a cosmetic way. So this is, again, dating ourselves to the 1980s. When you take a step forward, maybe one decade. So one decade later, the Pittsburgh group has kind of been the group most responsible for the cutting edge of this endoscopic approach to the skull base, published two experiences actually in this same year. So this is 1997. A couple of almost two decades back from today, about 15 years, the first thing they published was essentially their early experience with this conceptual technique of endoscopically removing tumors essentially from the pituitary initially. Everything kind of starts up at the pituitary and moves from there, and I'll talk about that as we move forward. But so their initial experience tended to be pituitary-oriented. Well, in the same year, 1997, they actually published not only their first experience, but then their experience on 50 patients. So they moved pretty quickly with this conceptually, and then were able to demonstrate through these endoscopes that they could get good visualization of the pituitary. This is in theory showing you the carotids and the optics. I can't tell where they are in this image, but in this drawing here, they're actually in theory showing you how they can remove the tumors endoscopically. And what we are trying to replace with this technique is, again, the necessity to do larger operations such as a craniotomy. And so it has been not uncommon over the last two decades, and we still do this today, for the craniotomy approach to the ethmoids, especially ethmoid tumors, has been the most commonplace. And even in the past, like I said, Dr. Cushing used an anterior craniotomy to get to the pituitary. This was felt to be a more direct route with more control and the ability to do on-bloc resections for tumors that required what we thought were on-bloc resections. Well, you know, you do a big craniotomy, you're going to get craniotomy side effects, especially with tumors that might require things like radiation therapy afterward. So there's a craniotomy incisions, there's plates placed to hold the craniotomy in place, and especially if you use things like back, you can get cosmetic deficits at the anterior skull base. You can get significant brain edema from brain retraction that older patients certainly don't tolerate well. And on occasions, especially post-radiation therapy, you can actually lose all of those reconstructive materials, including the anterior flap, and end up with large frontal defects. Or even worse, after radiation therapy, you can even lose the skin that covers those defects, and you're basically looking from the anterior skin of the forehead down into the nasal cavity with the dura behind it. Not a situation you particularly like. So why advanced surgery? Well, number one is to avoid these types of complications and do things safer and perhaps easier. So a couple other things that changed over time. Well, one, we actually were able to adopt what's called a subfrontal approach to the at least the ethmoid region for the most part. Also, the ability to use pericranial flaps for closure was brought forward. This did increase the safety of the anterior craniotomy approach for tumors, decrease the risk of significant postoperative complications, as I just alluded to. However, even with this approach, it's a relatively aggressive approach to get to the ethmoids. And it does leave a relatively large central defect even when it's done. This is a dural repair here, a large subfrontal craniotomy, and then the nasal cavity is down here, and there's a fair amount of dead space left between the two locations. A pericranial flap will slide in there, but this dead space does lead to air trapping in a fair amount of time where patients are at risk for things like CSF leak and meningitis. So what has changed? Well, in the modernization of this technique, we have developed new scopes. We have new control of the scopes, especially the ability to irrigate the scopes continually so they don't have to be removed from the patients. And I think this is a big step forward, in all honesty. There's new drills with better control in deep spaces. There's better computer navigation. And there's better closure to decrease CSF leaks. And there's a new belief in this approach, which I think is also very important. So again, we have these new better scopes. This continuous irrigation channel allows water to be irrigated through the scopes at all times with foot control, so you can actually leave the scope in place and essentially operate continuously. The good old days, and even in normal endoscopic surgery today, the scopes are removed, cleaned, and put back in multiple times during the operation, which is time-consuming and would be make this particular operation nearly impossible, although surgeons have done it that way in the past. Again, the drills are getting better. Azam can attest to this. There's a lot of drilling necessary to get bone away from the sphenoid and the clivus, and a good drill is your primary tool for that. So better drills are necessary. We do use a lot of intraoperative navigation, both with MRI and CT scan, and that can certainly be helpful in and around the carotid arteries, especially when you've got tumor blocking your view. Well, what about the pathology? Well, the pathology depends on what you look at. So this is the ethmoid pathologies that would commonly have been removed with a craniotomy approach in the past. And this was certainly the case when Al Ketchum reported his first experience in 1973. And so these tumors tend to be things that you'd find in the ethmoid. They're carcinomas, sarcomas, esthesioneuroblastomas, and then occasional meningioma. Well, what about the pathologies that I personally have had experience with? My initial experience dating from 1992 to 2001 was very similar to that of Dr. Ketchum's. This is excluding pituitary tumors, which basically I did not classify as anterior skull-based tumors at the time, but this huge variety of tumors, including things like inverting papillomas, chordomas, fibrous dysplasia, meningiomas, adenocarcinomas, adenocystic carcinomas, esthesioneuroblastomas, and a variety of other sarcomas. Well, in actual fact, if you look at our list today, and Azam just gave me this slide last night, which includes the majority of the tumors that we've done, some of these tumors are showing up on these lists. Sinus tumors such as inverting papillomas, neuroendocrine carcinomas, craniopharyngiomas, lymphomas, chordomas. Again, these are tumors that are mostly found more anteriorly. A lot of our focus initially began and continues at the pituitary, where we deal with both macroadenomas and microadenomas and a variety of functional, non-functional pituitary tumors. But it also extends to areas that I don't think is even listed on here, which is the craniovertebral junction, which can include chordomas and a variety of tumors, each with a unique pathology that has to be taken into consideration when you determine that you're going to do this endoscopically. And again, this just shows that. A high-grade malignancy, this is esthesioneuroblastomas, is significantly different than a low-grade malignancy. With esthesioneuroblastomas, the low-grade tumors actually do pretty well. Just getting the tumor out can be curative. High-grade tumors frequently need other things such as chemotherapy and radiation therapy after treatment and still have poor prognosis. They're basically just different tumors and need different considerations. Again, the tumor pathologies are diverse, and there's many degrees of freedom to compound the management choices. So every tumor has to be addressed based on your decision-making around what the pathology is going to be, whether complete resection is actually necessary, and whether when the resection is done, what the postoperative treatments might be, including things like radiation therapy. Again, I discussed the fact that there's a huge variety of tumors and occasionally non-tumors, such as encephaloceles and CSF leaks that are post-traumatic. All of these problems are amenable through this endoscopic anterior skull-based approach. Tumors that actually have been removed through more standard endoscopic techniques over the years, juvenile angiofibromas, nasal septal and sinus tumors, inverting papillomas, and nasal pharyngeal tumors are also amenable to this type of approach with, I think, a better control of these disease processes. Well, what about the way these tumors are taken out? The myth of the in-block resection. In actual fact, we all, as we've gone to endoscopic approaches, have realized that tumors can be removed in piecemeal fashion. And one of the most important parts of piecemeal fashion is still that the entire tumor is essentially removed. This is a study that we did a long time ago when I was still at Iowa, and we looked at anterior skull-based tumors and compared our quote-unquote in-block resections to our piecemeal resections. And initially, at the survival at 1 year, it looked like in-block might do a little bit better. But by 3 years, it was pretty obvious that there was probably no difference. The piecemeal resection patients actually were surviving better at this three-year mark with this small number of patients. However, this has also been shown in other institutions such as the group at Pittsburgh. When they do a debulking procedure, especially with malignant disease processes, the survival is around 17% compared to definitive resections in which the survival is reported to be around 62%. Obviously, a significant difference in the prognosis of the patient when a complete tumor resection can occur. So when we especially are dealing with malignant tumors, we do want to try to ensure that we can get the entire tumor removed through an endoscopic approach before taking that on. So things that we might not take on would be tumors that have significant dural involvement. We're not going to get good margins around this disease process over the orbit. We're not going to get good margins in the orbit. And so these types of tumors are best approached through a true transfacial or transcranial approach. Similarly with the orbital involvement, these are things that probably are not best treated with an endoscopic approach. This data just, again, supports that. When you've got dural invasion or brain invasion, Your survival is significantly worse. This is Dennis Krause's work from Memorial Sloan Kettering, again showing the significant difference between a tumor that can be completely removed due to its absence of dural invasion with a survival of 83% compared to those with dural invasion with a survival of 14%. This slide, I think, is interesting in that it's the MD Anderson data set, and it shows that again, there's some significant differences in survival between things like dural invasion, level invasion here, subdural or brain, meaning the brain invasion is significantly worse. They looked at it over here as gross total tumor resection, and again, if you've got gross total tumor resection, you do better than if you have incomplete tumor resection, and that again is significant. This is with margin control. So with the negative margin, your survival is significantly better than with a positive margin. But I think maybe the most interesting graph on this set of four is this one right here. This is en bloc versus piecemeal. It doesn't make a bit of difference. As long as you get the tumor out, the survival's the same. Okay, so I think that's my take-home point for that slide. So what are the advantages of an endoscopic approach? Well, in actual fact, the illumination and the light source are adjacent to your working field. You don't have a microscope, which you're being blocked by your hands or your nose or the patient's nose. There's a high-detailed, high-resolution, wide-angled view. You can use scopes that are 30, 45, and 70 degree if you want to. You can do a bilateral approach with high mobility of the surgical instruments. We believe, an improved differential between the tumor and the normal structures, and I've watched Azam work, and I know that he can tell a tumor from almost anything else in the anatomy back there, such that he can get a complete resection. And it avoids the potential complications associated with those open approaches. So what's accessible? Essentially, the areas that you'd expect to be accessible through an endoscopic view through the nose. The anterior cribriform region or the ethmoid region, the posterior ethmoid, sphenoid back to the pituitary, the clivus and the craniovertebral junction are all accessible endoscopically. A couple of quick pictures just in a still form as to what we tend to see when we're heading back toward the sphenoid sinus. Well, in normal anatomy, you have a sphenoidosteum. It doesn't look like this. This is cadaveric. It's always hard to find. This is the patient's right side and left side. And then right behind that is the sphenoid sinus. This is the septum in the middle. If you remove the posterior septum, if you remove the face of the sphenoid, then all of a sudden you actually can get in the center of the sphenoid with his inner sinus septi. The interesting thing is these septi always head to a carotid artery, so you have to take them out with some care. But then you can actually go behind that. You go behind the sphenoid, and you have the anatomy of most interest. You have the pituitary gland and the carotid artery and then the optic chiasm above it. And if you remove that arachnoid, this is what it could look like. This is cadaveric dissection. And Osmond would love to have a case where you could actually see this well, but it's always filled with a little bit of blood and thus the constant irrigation and suction necessary to do these procedures. But this is what's back there, carotid arteries, optic nerve, optic chiasm, pituitary gland, and in most cases, a large pituitary tumor or subadjacent tumor. This is clival bone down here, which is also frequently removed in many of the cases that we do. And as you go behind the clivus, you actually end up with the basilar artery and its associated structures, including lower cranial nerves. You can actually look down at the lower cranial nerves behind the a clivus, and this is actually heading down toward the internal auditory acoustic meatus. So what other things have changed that allow us to do these procedures? Well, we can avoid complications better. One is we can avoid CSF leaks by using improved repairs, specifically with flap repairs. So in the anterior skull base, the advance was the pericranial flap, which allowed us to put vascularized tissue between the brain and the nose. Endoscopically, it's really the advancement of what's called a septal flap. And we use septal flaps in almost all of our cases, although it's controversy as to which ones actually need a big septal flap. We tend to believe in these flaps. They're based off a branch of the posterior septal artery. And the artery is a lateral artery below the sphenoid recess, so we can actually take these flaps, tuck them out of the way, and then have them available at the end of the operation. The anatomy is relatively well described. You can make relatively large flaps. It's kind of an odd diagram, but this is the floor of the nose, and this is the septum. And the arterial supply comes from lateral beneath the sphenoid os. And then you can harvest basically the septal mucosa off the entire ipsilateral septum and use that for reconstructive purposes. So just a couple of pictures of things that were obviously tumors that would be straightforward endoscopic type tumors. You know, a small meningioma in the middle of the sphenoid sinus, where else are you going to get there except through the nasal cavity? Same thing with a small chordoma centered right in the heart behind the sphenoid sinus. Essentially, these things are just begging to come out endoscopically. This one, maybe not so obviously, this is the craniovertebral junction, which we used to approach non-endoscopically all the time and with open approaches when I used to work with Arnold Menesis. This is an area that is available to us as endoscopic skull-based surgeons, and it's one of those things that we're gaining more and more experience with, and I think Azam may talk about one of our cases that is craniovertebral junction tumor. But as you can see here, it's basically directly behind the soft palate, and is directly below the clivus and is an area that we can reach with the endoscopic techniques and have done so successfully. We don't know what skull-based surgery are. They continue to be expanded by a variety of surgical groups around the world, in actual fact, and it's a huge and frequent topic at our skull-based society meetings, and still completely up in the air as to where we'll end up drawing the limits around what's available to be removed endoscopically. But all the areas from the frontal recess back to the craniovertebral junction are accessible endoscopically. Depending on the type of tumor identified and the skills of the surgeon, it's becoming the case where almost any tumor that is not invading brain or vital structures can be removed safely and with good patient survival endoscopically. And my last slide here deals with the idea of teamwork. And I do believe that teamwork's an essential thing. Azam and I have been a team here doing this for 2.5 years now. Mustafa Biskaya, his partner, and I have, as well as Greg Harding and others in our group, have been working as teams here. Sam Goebbels, Mark Pyle in the lateral. And it's a great thing for otolaryngology and neurosurgery working together to expand the patient care to our patients. So the bottom line is teamwork does help. It basically allows two individuals with two different groups of types of experience to come together for the advancement of patient care. And so with that, I'm actually going to ask Azam to come up and show us a few cases, just I think to give you a flair for what we're doing here at Wisconsin. All right.
So I really lucked out in taking this job because you have the best possible scenario as a new faculty. You have a chairman who can potentially shoulder any complications that you have. And so this is the best possible scenario as a new faculty.
Maybe we need to do this too.
Do we need to do this?
Maybe. I think we needed to push that button. Okay.
Okay, so just wanted to show some like. What's the deal, guys? Where's the candid camera? All right, there we go. Sorry. hostile environment here. So just want to show some cases and things that we've done here over the past couple of years. It's been great working with Tim, and I think gave me some bravery in a lot of the cases that I did, knowing that he was there to help out. So pituitary tumors are the main pathology that we contend with far and away, and this is familiar territory. It allowed me to gain experience, and then I'll show you some cases that really push the limits of what endonasal surgery can do. So pituitary tumors can have significant supracellular extension. My mouse isn't showing up here, but And then if you look at the top left panel, here it is, okay. They can also extend laterally to the cavernous sinuses and even invade into the cavernous sinus. As in this tumor here, there's some cavernous sinus invasion. That's not necessarily that big of a problem if you approach these tumors endoscopically, because we can stop the bleeding very easily. Whereas with a microscopic approach, really working into a corner and trying to visualize where the bleeding is coming from is very difficult. So the pre-op images in each one of these four cases is on the top, and the post-operative images are on the bottom. So some additional pituitary tumors, various morphologies, and some with extensive suprasellar extension. And all of these can be visualized with very nice detail, because the operative corridor that we're taking really takes advantage of encountering the tumor first. And the tumor has really blazed the trail and given us the visualization. So as we debulk the tumor, we can see more and more of it, even if it extends quite far into the suprasellar region up here abutting the optic chiasm. So just to give you an example of how of one of these cases, this is here's a typical pituitary adenoma being resected endoscopic endonasally. What's been done up to this point is that all the portions of the procedure that Dr. McCulloch laid out have been completed. And this is where I start the resection. So the sphenoid rostrum has been removed. We're looking through the sphenoid sinus. The floor of the cella has also been drilled out. And so this is the dura underlying the pituitary gland here, and that you can see. The endoscope is introduced through the right nostril. And this suction is in the left nostril. In the right nostril as well. And so the view's inverted here. And we can work bimanually with one hand, the suction hand in one nostril, and the dissecting instrument in the other nostril. So it's true bimanual dissection. This is one of our early cases. And here is a resection of the bone along the intercavernous sinus. Here's opening the dura, and you can start to see the tumor here. The dura is being retracted posteriorly. And as these flaps of the dura are incised, the tumor will be dissected circumferentially using a capsular dissection technique. Capsular dissection is not something that's commonly performed, but I think in places where there's some studies that show that it leads to a better outcome with regards to achieving a gross total resection. With a microscopic approach, this type of visualization is not possible, and therefore a extracapsular dissection technique is very, very difficult. Some people are able to do it with a microscope, but it's very difficult. Here it's I'm dissecting the tumor away from the dural leaflet. And you'll start to see that the tumor will start to bulge into the field as this tumor is dissected circumferentially. The cavernous sinuses are here laterally, and after the tumor has been dissected circumferentially as much as possible, the tumor is debulked here. The cavernous sinus is just on the other side of this dural leaflet, so we're working right next to that and peeling the tumor right off of it. And then anteriorly, you'll see the pituitary, the normal pituitary gland is maintained here. And that's very important. Obviously, you don't want to turn these patients into endocrinologic cripples by removing a benign tumor. So it's very important that the pituitary gland be maintained. This is a view looking at the diaphragma cella, so the dura on the other side of the tumor. So in this particular patient, this was a tumor that we were contending with, a mid-sagittal section and a coronal section of that tumor. And here's the resection that we're able to achieve. This here is the nasal septal flap reconstruction, and that's why there's some enhancement there. And that flap reconstruction is very important in order to avoid postoperative cerebral spinal fluid leaks. This is, if you contrast this with the microscopic view, this is one of my cases from residency, and this is the view that's that you can achieve, and this is really quite optimized. What you're looking down is that nasal speculum from the time of Cushing and from the early 1900s that's still used today, and what you can see here is that the view is very limited, and it really requires a lot of movement of the microscope in order to look into the various corners. It also requires sometimes that the surgery be done by Braille, essentially just by feel of the tumor using ring curettes and internal debulking of the tumor. It's a bit disconcerting with working in high-priced real estate, cavernous sinuses on either side, the carotid artery on either side, optic chiasm is above you, and the basilar artery is posterior to you. So all these important structures, and a lot of it is it continues to be done by feel with the microscopic approach. So going to posterior as you extend these approaches, here's a small meningioma at the anterior skull base involving the olfactory groove, an olfactory groove meningioma. And oftentimes, smaller tumors may seem like they're easier to take out, but in this case, if this tumor was larger, it would make it actually easier to take out because it would have displaced the brain posteriorly. And then we can work through a cord or something like this, avoiding the frontal sinus and be able to access the tumor. Here, if you take this approach, a brain retraction in order to remove this tiny tumor. And this patient presented with seizures. So all that brain retraction would cause even more seizures down the road. So the approach that we took here was an endoscopic endonasal one, and you can see the preoperative imaging here and the postoperative resection with analogous cuts here. I don't think that displays very well, but you can see that the tumor is gone. And this patient actually had a grade 2 tumor, was radiated, and about a year and a half out has not had any recurrences. So going on to some of the more complex pathologies, so this is the clivus here, so moving down inferiorly a little bit. The nose and the coina are here, the oropharynx is here, and posterior to that, between the clivus and C1 and C2, you can see that there's a T2 hyperintense mass. This is a very characteristic location for a chordoma. Chordoma is a difficult pathology that we deal with. It's one where even though it has OMA in the name and not sarcoma, this tends to have a worse prognosis than a chondrosarcoma in the similar location due to the fact that oftentimes gross total resection is more easily achieved for chondrosarcomas, whereas for chordomas, these tend to pose a challenge surgically to achieve a gross total resection. Here's a coronal image as well of this tumor. It has the appearance of a thyroid, I think, if I remember back to my residency, where it has a two halves and a bit of an isthmus here. And so it does extend quite a bit inferiorly as well, so right at the craniocervical junction. And this is a young woman, a 33-year-old woman as well. So it's very important to try to achieve the best resection possible the first time around. That's always the easiest time to approach this and attempt to achieve a gross total resection. So here's the analogous axial cuts. And what you can see here is that the... Sorry about that. So what you can see here is that this T2 hyperintense tumor is displacing the brainstem posteriorly. And here are the vertebral arteries on either side of it as well at the upper aspect of the tumor. Some additional cuts through this tumor, you can see how far it does extend laterally. And as well down to the craniocervical junction involving C2 here, it's replaced a lot of the clivus as well. And the inferior aspect of it, you can see the C1, anterior arch of C1, and the tip of the dens here as well. So, and there's tumor behind all of those structures. So the other important thing to note here is that the carotid arteries are on either side of the tumor here. And so that poses some additional challenges as well. So our operative plan was to approach this initially endonasally and see what we could achieve through an endonasal approach. And if there was a further resection required, we could approach it through the mouth. We knew that there was a pretty high chance that we would need to go through the mouth, through a transoral approach, given the fact that you can make an approximation with the nasopalatal line, and it tells us that we would get barely to the mid portion of the tumor here. So here's the video of the of this resection, and just to orient you up to this point, this is a kind of a starting from somewhat the beginning. The middle turbinate's been resected. The nasal septum is here, with the nasal septal flap already having been harvested and retracted down into the nasopharynx. So first, the sphenoid ostium is identified. That's the first approach, and this is Dr. McCulloch finding that. And after removing the last parts of the middle turbinate, the sphenoid ostium is identified here. The after that, the mucosa is stripped off of this. A posterior septostomy has been performed, as well as resection of the posterior posterior bony septum. This is the last bit of vomer here and sphenoid rostrum. And so this will be resected as well in order to get that panoramic view into the sphenoid sinus, drilling off the last bit of the vomer there. And so this is the view into the sphenoid sinus. Here's the cella. And the sphenoid rostrum blends into the clivus, and really that needs to be drilled all the way down in order to approach this tumor. The attachments of the longus capitis muscle are really tenacious here. One of the muscles that allows us to flex our head and hold up the 10 to 12 pounds of our head day in and day out. After extensive dissection of that, the drill is used to resect the clivus along the superior aspect. The visualization that we have here is something that is very difficult to achieve even with an open approach. You can start to see this gelatinous tumor posterior to the clivus. And once the superior aspect of the tumor is identified, just skip along here a little bit, start working inferiorly. This longus capitis muscle is is quite large as well. And so trying to retract that poses a challenge. After that, we approach this through the mouth. This is a view after Dingman retractor has been placed. This is an incision in the oropharyngeal mucosa and identification of the upper part of the clivus here. Laterally, the tumor here is identified, and you can see that the capsule is dissect circumferentially around the tumor on the right side here. And then similarly, same process will be performed on the left-hand side. And obviously this is a painstaking dissection. This is a rather long 12-hour surgery performed over a couple of days in order to achieve a good resection. I won't belabor this any further. So post-operative, here's the preoperative imaging, and then the post-operative imaging with analogous cuts, you can see that the tumor has been removed, the brainstem has returned to a normal position, and we were able to achieve what seems to be a gross total resection up to this point. She's about 9 months out, and so it's a bit early to say what we've been able to achieve with that, but hopefully she'll have a long survival from this. So this is a traditional approach, this is a bit gruesome for the approaches that we do in neurosurgery. A similar tumor in a similar location, and the traditional approach has been nauseating even having done a couple of these. This is a retractor that's being placed through the mouth and coming out below the mandibles. This shouldn't be done in general. This is the mandible that's been split, and this is a good reconstruction. The tongue's been split here, is one half of it, one half on the other side. A tracheostomy has been performed, and this kind of harkens back a little bit to the predator, and so we kind of joke about this being the predator operation, but you can see the resemblance there to that. The endoscopic approach for these tumors has added quite a bit. So just in full disclosure, this patient had extensive dissection also of the condyles bilaterally. Here's the C1 anterior arch that's been drilled. The tip of the dens is gone. And so she did end up needing an occipital cervical fusion, which I performed after she demonstrated some subluxation here. And she's doing very well, back to work. So some additional tumors, a different approach for a tumor in a similar location. This is a retroclival mass. The chordoma was anterior to clivus. This one is a bit more challenging, posterior to the clivus, and an intradural as well. And so these tumors are very, very challenging because they tend to incorporate neurovascular structures, and there's important cranial nerves here. Extensive tumor extending all the way down from C2 all the way up to the clivus. The traditional approaches for this would be some sort of a combined lateral skull base approach, like a far lateral combined with a transpetrosal approach as well. And even then, it would be very difficult to get to the ventral aspect of the brainstem. In this approach, or in the nasal approach, you can approach this through the nose, drill down the clivus, drill down C2, as in the last example, open the dura, and resect the tumor. This patient was elderly, and so the goals of the surgery were a bit different. Intraoperatively, the tumor was a benign fibromyxoid type tumor, so we weren't very aggressive with it and did not attempt to. I don't know what happened there. I did not attempt to achieve a gross total resection for that tumor. So here's just a couple of examples of some cases that we've done approaching from anterior to posterior skull base along with some pituitary tumors. And I think that over time, as more complex pathologies and also lateral pathologies come our way, we'll be able to address those as well. I think that this approach has really added quite a bit to the possibilities that we can provide to our patients, and also their post-operative recovery as well is much quicker with these approaches as opposed to the predator approach and other similar lateral skull base approaches. So thank you for your attention. I appreciate it.